So let's dive right in. This is the first video in a new format that I'm doing on the channel of breaking down effects in their entirety from start to finish and kind of running through some of the ideas, thought processes, how you can actually use Blender to make a final finished figure. Now, what we're looking at right now is a simple recreation of a TOC that I made yesterday, the day before, put it on Instagram, and just added a little bit of animation for flair. So you could see that here, we've got this ping coming into the center. We have a rotating molecule on a very simple background, and we're going to essentially make this from start to finish. Before I do that, I'm going to talk about where this work comes from. So it is originally from an article, Dissipative Dynamics of Polymer Phenonic Materials, that comes from two institutes, one in the Netherlands and one in Italy. And if I come to my little reference board here, you can see this is the TOC that showed up with it when I found it in my journal feed. So if we undo the crop there, you can see Dissipative Dynamics, Polymer Phenonic Materials. And essentially what I wanted to do was recreate this effect in Blender, start to finish, and then add a little bit of flair just for animation. So with that said, let's get underway and dive into Blender. Here we go. Now there's a number of ways that you could do this very simply, but I'm gonna do it in a way that adds a little bit of modularity. And the reason for that is kind of, well, I'll touch on it as I go along, but I like to be able to adjust things as I go and come back more or less easily later on. So we'll go ahead, we'll delete the default cube. I'm going to add in a simple plane. In edit mode, I'll add two loop cuts with Control R, first this way and then this way, scrolling up on the mouse to get the two. Now I'll hit two for edge select, grab this edge over here, hit E to extrude, and I'm just going to go for 0.25 in the X direction. I'm also going to go for 0.25 in the Y direction. So same thing here, E to extrude, Y for that direction, and then minus 0.25. Now these are matched. Because I want this to be the same on the other side, I'll come to the modifiers and add a mirror, making sure to use the X and Y. I'll also apply this. Now, I'd like to make a little grid out of these, so I'm going to go ahead, add an array modifier. I'll choose merge here, and I'm going to go with a count of probably about 5. I'm also going to shift D to duplicate this, change the factor to 1 for the Y, 0 for the X, same idea here, and now I have my nice little grid ready to go. We'll go ahead and apply both of these. If you don't see these options at the top, that's just because I have a modifier enabled, or rather an add-on enabled, called Modifier Tools. It ships with Blender by default. I'm not sure if it's actually active though, so it's free. You can add it if you like. Go ahead, apply that. And now what I'm going to do is right-click on this, choose Origin to Geometry, which you can see is placed the origin here, and then Alt-G to reset the origin to the center of the world. From here, what I'd like to do is set up the external plane. So you can see in the original figure, or rather if I bring it back, we'll take a look at the original figure. In the original figure, there's the cross-hatching, but then there's an exterior part that is essentially just a flat plane. And there's a number of ways we could do that. We're gonna do it in kind of a cheating way, because often with figures, what you're going for is just the thing that works. It doesn't need to be perfect. It really doesn't. So go ahead, add a plane, scale that up. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to tab into edit mode, hit I for inset, and I'm going to drag it in just until just about the edges. And again, like I said, it really does not have to be perfect. We're just going to kind of line it up until it works in camera. And that's going to be more than good enough. I'm going to hit X and delete this internal face. Next, I really want to make sure that I have the scale applied on this. So Control A and apply scale. And I'll also apply the scale on this. And we're going to add a solidify modifier. I'm going to change the offset to 1, and I'll bring the thickness up to something 0.25 to start. I'll be able to adjust this at any time. I'm going to do the same thing for this. So I'll add a solidify, offset of 1, 0.25. But in this case, what I would like here is not to actually have to go back and change both of them every time. So I'll right click here, choose copy as new driver, and then I'll come over here and I will paste that driver. And what that means is that this one, the cross-hatching, is now the master and it will update both. And so you can see we've already achieved the effect we want. If we really need to at any point in time, we can come here, hit 2 for edge select, so I'm in edit mode on the exterior plane, and then we could scale this out. And now we have more of an edge, less of the cross-hatching, but when we re-enable the solidify, you won't actually even be able to tell that there's a sort of cutoff here. So it'll look perfect in the render. If we actually come to rendered view, you see, it looks like it's just merging seamlessly, so we've got the effect we're after. Now, there is one other thing that I'd like to do here, and let's just quickly take stock. Ah, yes, I'd like to organize things, because even though this is going to be a relatively simple scene, I do think it pays dividends to name your stuff, because if someone else has to work on this, or if you have to come back to it later, just have everything labeled. So we'll call this crosshatching. And we'll call this border. Now from here, we're gonna actually get set up with the little ping effect. So you can see that there's this sort of series of concentric circles. There's all kinds of ways to do this. I'm actually going to borrow this from a tutorial from the Default Cube channel. So it's essentially creating pings. If you're not aware of who Default Cube, also known as CG Matter, is, he makes tutorials on YouTube for a number of different effects. And that's one of the things about Blender and science. There aren't that many channels that are devoted specifically to scientific content, but there are a lot of channels that are devoted to artistic content. So if you're looking for an effect like this, you might find it. I'm not going to run through the entirety of the tutorial. Essentially what it does is it creates a material that lets you get that effect. I've already made it, so I'm going to append it. If you want to know how to make it, check out his tutorial. So go ahead, just search on YouTube Default Cube Pings, and that should bring it up right away. But to do that, we're very simply going to Shift A, add a plane. I'll drag it above my crosshatching, and then I'll tab into edit mode and scale it up just a bit. Something like that should be more or less fine. We'll open a new window, come to the shader editor, and then I'm going to go File, Append, come to where I know that I've already made that. So down here, CG Matter, Pings. And then I'm going to append the node tree. So the node tree is essentially what's going to allow me to create this effect. I'll hit new, and then I'm going to hit Shift A, group, and node group. Now I have this node group because I already appended it from the actual file. You would have to just make this. And if you actually follow the tutorial, essentially what the tutorial does is it shows you all of the steps to get there. So it'll give you this effect. So, taking advantage of all of that, where is my return? There it is. Good. Essentially, what this does, or how it works, is I'm going to choose whatever color I want for the ping. We'll come to a rendered view for this. And then I'm going to plug the value output here into the alpha. And you can think of alpha as basically a degree of transparency. If it's completely zero or black, then it's not going to show up in camera at all. We do have to, in Eevee at least, enable that. So we'll enable ambient and screen space. And you can see that's going to add some curious jitter there. But what we're basically going to do is turn off the shadows, and for blend mode, we'll come down and choose alpha clipped. Now this can be a little bit frustrating sometimes. It does not always play along. And actually the easiest way to do this is just to work with it in cycles. So the original animation that I showed you at the beginning was done in cycles. We might just save ourselves some time and see if that'll work. So there we go. We can see it's working in cycles. That's white. What we want is some sort of color. So the original palette that I went for was some kind of coffee adjacent sort of look. So if we go back, you can see muted tones, a little bit more matte, and then a darker kind of brown here and a brighter orange. So that was sort of the look that I was after there. Let's just see if we can pick that up. And we'll try and do this on the GPU. Hopefully it will actually not overload. I tried to record this before and it really didn't want to play along because it was just overtaxing to do all the video recording and this at the same time. In any event, what this does is it lets us control a number of things. So I can control the number of rings. You can see that right here. This is a little bit more dense. I can control how fast they move. So actually right now they are animated. And if we come back into a live view, that's frustrating. But if we come back into a live view, you can see that they're actually all going to sort of zoom and move in. So I can control the speed of that by either making it faster by lowering this number, or I can make it slower by increasing the number. There's also a setting for edge falloff here that we don't really need to worry about right now. Instead, what I'm going to do is just increase the size of this by scaling the whole thing up. So in this case, I'm actually doing this in object mode, not in edit mode. That's important because it is going to have a different effect. And then if I come in and look at the rendered view, this is what I have. So already very close to the final figure. All I need is a molecule. Now, molecules, I have a separate tutorial on how to make pretty much any molecule you want. But today we're actually just going to go ahead and take advantage of some existing molecules that I've made that are available for free. And I'll add links to those in the description for anyone who's interested. It does annoy me to have this much extra space around this, so we're going to see if we can get away with shrinking this in. I'm not confident we can, but we'll give it a shot. There we go, that works perfectly. So now we have our pings located just in the center where we wanted, and we don't have all that extra overhanging plane. And we're actually also going to rename this to pings. So now we have our nice organized scene. I'm also going to turn on a few extra options. I don't know why these aren't available by default. I really feel like the render one at least should be on, but this is all right. We're then going to add materials to our cross-hatching. So not our pings, there we go, our cross-hatching. And in the original, again, this was kind of a darker color. I made it sort of, like I said, coffee-esque was sort of what I was going for. You could also label your materials. So in this case, I've heard before, don't call your materials after colors because you might change them. So this would be base materials. And then this one would be the ping material. As for the molecule, what I'm simply going to do is go to File, Append, and under Assets. So these are some of the assets that I've made and published. They're for free. You can get them on Gumroad or BlendSwap. And today, let's go with a common molecule and see what options we have available to us. So the original that I posted was caffeine, but we might want to go for something a little bit more interesting. Let's go with menthol today. So I'll drag that up. I can just scale this as well. And in this case, what I actually want to do is, because it's menthol, let's change the color scheme. So again, I said don't go with colors because you might change them. So for menthol, let's do some kind of bluey green type thing instead. We'll go with that, and then we'll change this to just about there. So this is what we're going to go for. Again, we're, you know, the shininess here doesn't necessarily match, so this is the asset as you receive it. I will actually mute these by bringing the roughness values up quite a bit higher. So 0.65 for each one. Let's see. There we go. Not bad. And again, if I want to, I could change the colors of these. So let's say I want my hydrogens to be just a little bit more menthol-y. I can change the color there. Perfect. So now I hit 0 on the number pad, so I'm in my camera view. I'll hit end to open this side panel, choose camera to view, and now I can start looking at some extra options here. Something like this. Very nice. Now, I do want some sort of background plane. So to get that to work, I'm simply going to Shift A, add plane. I'll scale that up quite a good bit. And now I'm going to do a nice little trick that I like to use for scene staging. So I'll grab my camera, hit 0 on the number pad. I will select this plane, come down to the object constraints, and add a copy rotation for the camera. Then I'll make sure that's only active in the Z axis. Tab into edit mode, grab this back face, E and Z to scale it up. I will make sure that I've applied the scale on this plane, and then I'll grab this rear facing edge, Control B to bevel, smooth that out, and I can move this around just a little bit. Something like that should be fine. S and X twice, so you scale locally. This will be our backdrop. And now if I wanted to, I could grab my camera again and we could rotate around this from any view and the backdrop will largely follow us. So if you wanted the shadows from one angle versus another, this is a nice way to do that. And you have this background that's going to follow you pretty much at all times. I find this light here a little bit harsh. I think it's casting shadows that are a little bit too hard. So I'm going to change the radius from 0.1 to 1. We got a little bit smoother shadows there. That's very nice. And of course, if we wanted to, we could add more light. So I'll Shift D, duplicate this, bring it over here, bring it up, something like that. And we could add a slight mint tinge to it as well by making it a little bit green. Perfect. As for the background, we'll shade that smooth, and we could also add a color to that if we want to. In this case, I'm just going to make it kind of pure white. So that's not bad to start. How are we going to get this thing to animate and spin? Because that was kind of the nice little thing that we had going on. And the other thing that I'd like for it to do is I would like it to kind of bounce up and down gently in frame. That's a little bit more advanced, but it's kind of fun, so let's give it a shot. The first thing I'm going to do is on the absolute first frame that I'm going to go with, so frame 1, I'm going to hit I, and I'm going to add a location and rotation keyframe to my menthol. Then I'm going to choose how long I want my scene to be. In this case, I'd like it to be 72 frames, so 3 seconds, 24 frames per second. So I'm going to end on frame 71, actually, and then I'm going to change to frame 72. Hit RZ 360, so I've spun it 360 degrees by frame 72. We'll add in a location rotation keyframe there. And then what I'm going to do is come down to this little animation bar, hit T, and make sure we're set to linear. Now what that's going to do in material preview is if I just go ahead and press, you can see It's now going to spin, and if I actually manage to get this working properly, then it should, with a linear step, just loop seamlessly. So there's no pause there. It's just going to keep going. So you have to make sure that these are actually yellow when you hit T for linear, and then it will spin very seamlessly. For the up and down, there's a number of ways I could do this, but I want to do it in a way that I'm going to kind of have to not really worry about actually manually keyframing. So that's going to be a little bit more complex, and we added that location keyframe for exactly this purpose. We're going to open a new window, and we're going to change to the graph editor. Under the objects, I'm going to choose the Z location, hit N for the side panel, add a modifier, and choose a built-in function, which by default will give me sine. That's almost perfect. You can see right now it's sent the molecule too low, so I need to change a few of these values, starting with the value offset. That's going to bring it up. And then I'm going to lower the amplitude so it only moves up and down a little. So if we go ahead and press play, you can see it's bouncing now. Obviously, it's bouncing way too fast, so we're going to change the phase multiplier here to slow that down quite a bit. Now you can see we've got something nice and gentle. And of course, the point that we'd like is for this point in the wave and this point in the wave to essentially be the same. So we can do that pretty simply. I'm going to aim for starting at a kind of a peak and then ending at that same peak. So we'll change the phase offset. And it might be helpful to do this with a little bit stronger of an amplitude just so you can see what you're working with. So again, let's go with the phase offset here. That's a peak. And now we're just going to speed this up by changing the phase multiplier until we have peak to peak, essentially there, up and down. Very nice. That's a little bit too high, so we can now bring our amplitude lower. And we can, of course, bring the value lower as well, so it starts a little bit lower. Something like that, pretty much perfect. And if we come back, we can see this is kind of our final product. So most computers, mine included, will not be able to keep up with this in cycles in real time if you're rendering, but you can pause at any time and then switch to render view, see what it is, and you could render out into every individual frame here in cycles. And essentially what you get at the end is something that looks a lot like this, except obviously we added a nice little bouncing effect. So that's essentially it. From start to finish, we just made a figure in Blender. This would have been fine as a TOC, so we could have stopped, not done any of the animation. The animation is just a nice little flair that we've added at the end, kind of for fun. So if that's at all interesting to you, look forward to more videos like these. I will be doing other figure breakdowns, so you can see we've got plenty to choose from. Some of the ones that are next up on the list are using procedural textures to recreate aspects of this. This ChemCom figure, I believe I know the person who did this, and many of the aspects of it are available either through my channel as tutorials, so how to make this cell structure, how to make the pills, you can find those on my channel. Brady Johnston has some excellent stuff covering a lot of the membrane work as well. Many of these others are also worthwhile, and from the larger collection, we'll be looking at how to break down a few of these in some of these longer format live recreations. So as always, thanks for coming out. If you found this interesting or useful, consider subscribing, sharing with your friends and colleagues. Get out there and make some fantastic figures. Until next time, you have yourselves a great old day.